Welcome to Lingthusiasm, a podcast that's enthusiastic about linguistics. I'm Lauren Gawne.
And I'm Gretchen McCulloch. And today we're getting enthusiastic about copulas. But first, in April, we're going to be doing a live Q&A bonus episode for patrons, which will be virtual and hanging out on our Discord.
We'll be returning to one of our most popular bonus episode topics for an entire Q&A about swearing.
Full disclosure, this will be a sweary episode with swears in it, so ask us your sweary questions, get some sweary answers, and go to patreon.com/lingthusiasm to find out how to become a patron and join the Discord for the live show, which will also be released as an edited May bonus episode if you're not so keen on live audio chats.
Patrons, get your questions ready and keep an eye out for more details closer to the event.
The Lingcom grants are also happening again in 2022. These are grants to support projects who are bringing linguistics communication to broader audiences.
Submissions are open till the end of March 2022, and you can find out more details at lingcom.org. That's Lingcom with two M's.
I've been looking up some classic quotes lately.
Have you been looking for some inspiration?
Yeah, well, I'm looking for some grammatical inspiration.
Okay, let me hear some that have been speaking to you.
Best quote reading voice.
Okay.
It was the best of times, it was the worst of times.
Mm-hmm.
The pen is mightier than the sword.
We're really going for the cliches. I love it.
Time is money, Lauren!
Okay, so this might not be the reason other people browse classic quotes lists, but as far as I can tell, you're into all of these because they have is or was in them.
That's right!
You're looking for these, like, tiny little function words.
That's absolutely right. I was looking for examples of copulas, and I thought I would try some classic quotes because quotes are sometimes very copularific. Can I tell you what my favorite?
Yeah. Have you got some more?
Okay. So this one's the best. It goes, knowledge is power. France is bacon.
I think you might have got confused here. I think this is a quote attributed to Francis Bacon.
No. The thing that I'm quoting is actually the Reddit thread where somebody realized that they had been mishearing this quote their entire life as France copula bacon rather than by a guy named Francis whose surname was Bacon.
When I was fact-checking this episode for us, I actually found an entire website, franceisbacon.com, that exclusively exists, that has this anecdote on it, and you can buy a t-shirt with the French flag in the shape of a strip of bacon.
We are not sponsored by franceisbacon.com.
Truly a magic single-serve website. And a more surreal example of where you might put a copula.
Yeah, so in France is Bacon, for example, the copula is doing this thing of linking the concept of France to say that it is like somehow the concept of bacon. And a copula verb is from a Latin word meaning linking or joining or combining, and that's what it's doing. It's linking those two halves of the sentence and sort of equating them.
I assume that co in copula is the same as like in combine and co-op, that with co.
Yes, it is. And it is actually related to copulate, as you might wonder. But the grammatical sense is actually older than the other sense.
There you go.
And the thing that sort of fascinates me about copulas is that they're this essentially one word, although sort of one word with an asterisk because is and was and were and am and stuff and be are all forms of this one word, that gets its whole own name in grammatical description.
Hmm. I hadn't really thought about that before, but it reminds me a bit of schwa, how we have this one sound that has its own name that has nothing to do with its functions necessarily. It's just so unique in the set of sounds for schwa and verbs for copulas that they have their own name.
Yeah, and normally we talk about sort of classes of verbs, you know, maybe these verbs all have both a subject and an object, and these verbs only have a subject or something like that. You have transitive and intransitive. Like, we often have names for groups of verbs. But copula gets to be its own thing because there isn't really any other verb that's exactly like is and was in that whole class of verbs.
should probably just mention as well that they don't have to just occur in profound inspirational quotes. Copulas pop up all over the place. So you can have a much more practical use, such as Lingthusiasm is a podcast.
The Lingthusiasm logo is green. A podcast that is enthusiastic about linguistics. Indeed.
And these are nice because these examples show how the two things that get linked don't have to always be the same types of things. So you could link one noun with another noun. So Lingthusiasm is a noun and podcast is a noun. But for something like the logo is green, that's an adjective. So it's linking a noun to its attribute. Or you could link a noun with a location, like the Lingthusiasm transcripts are on the Lingthusiasm website.
Mm, very nice. Or it could be a possession, you know, the Lingthusiasm podcast is ours.
Exactly. So linking here is a very broad concept of what can be linked.
And I think the other reason why we have a special name for copulas is because when it comes to the form of a copula, like if you want to talk about walk as a verb, you can just be like, well, the verb walk, it does the following properties. But if you want to try to talk about copula as a verb, you're left saying, well, the verb is, which is also was, which is also be, which is also where and am and being and been. And it's got so many forms compared to the relative scarcity of forms that other verbs in English have.
And all these different forms are just part of the paradigm for this one verb. Even though they all look very differently, they're treated as variations on the same verb when we're thinking about how they function.
And because many languages, probably most languages, but I haven't checked all 7,000, have some form of copula, and it tends to be a very common thing to do to say that two things are roughly similar to each other, it's a very common verb, and so it's more likely to be irregular in a lot of languages than other types of verbs that are a bit less common. So it's also useful to have this type of verb when you're doing cross-linguistic comparisons to say, how does the copula show up in these particular languages? Because you're relatively often dealing with a verb that has lots of irregular forms.
Yeah, that is maybe a thing you've encountered when learning a new language, is that for the copula, you're more likely to have to learn more than one way of dealing with it, because we put up with a lot of irregularity in verbs that we use all the time. If we had like very different forms of the verb subscribe, we don't use that verb very much. It would be a lot more effort to retain all those different forms.
Yeah, exactly. And something that's interesting about the copula forms in at least a lot of European languages is that they are often historically drawing some forms from one verb and some forms from another, and they've been sort of smushed together to make this like Frankenverb.
Mm-hmm.
So this is why we have the be, been, being forms, which are originally from one verb that's traced back historically, and the was, were forms, which are traced back to a different verb. And I think that like these are forms are from like yet a third one. And the same thing, like in French, you have the suis, je suis, tu es, il est forms. And then also in the future tense, there's forms with an F in a lot of Romance languages that was smushed together from another verb. So there's lots of sort of weird stuff going on for historical reasons there.
Another thing that can make copula hard to spot in the wild with English is that because they are used so frequently, they get reduced a lot, and they can just become even little clitics that stick onto the ends of other words. We have a whole episode on clitics and how they are commonly used forms that get reduced. So she's a really great linguist. That's there is the copula as a reduced form, or I'm really enthusiastic about linguistics. That there is that little bit of am.
Yeah, and there's negative forms of the copula too. You know, you have isn't, aren't, wasn't. And one of the things that interests me is that there isn't quite a mainstream English form of am not that's contracted.
I am not. Yeah, that's right. I don't have amant in my variety of English.
Yeah, so amant is found in Ireland, maybe a few other places, but it's not in my English. I haven't encountered it. And traditionally speaking, like historically, if we wanted to use a contracted negation form of am and not, that's actually ain't.
Ah, it is true, but ain't has fallen out of favor and ruined the paradigm. It's a very sad tale.
Yeah, And so, you know, ain't has this sort of stigmatized association because it was, so it was originally a contraction of am not and totally reasonably used like that. And then it also began to be used as a generic contraction of are not, is not, has not, and a bunch of other forms. And that sort of became associated with representations of stigmatized dialect in place, things like Dickens representing Cockney. And then people started getting, yeah, really angry about it and making it not a thing for as many people anymore. But like now we're left with this gap, which I don't think is an improvement, really.
So between the variety of functions, the irregularity of form, the ability to reduce it in certain contexts, no wonder copulas need their own name. They do so much.
They do so much. And, you know, again, most of our other verbs don't get their own reduced forms. Like, this is a thing that happens with really frequent stuff.
And just to make things extra tricky with a copula, I have a couple of quotes to share back to you, Gretchen.
Okay, thank you. Please.
I think, therefore I am. And of course, we couldn't have a copular episode without talking about to be or not to be.
Uh-huh.
But for both of these, there's no linking happening.
There isn't any linking happening. I think, therefore I am, to be or not to be, to be what, you know?
That is the question.
Okay, I walked into that. If Hamlet is going around saying, like, to be alive or not to be alive, or, you know, to be Hamlet or not to be Hamlet, then he'd be using, technically speaking, a copula in its linking sense. Mm-hmm. But in to be or not to be, where it's just to exist or not to exist, that is, technically speaking, not quite a copula because it isn't doing that linking thing.
Yeah.
However, and this is a very large however, because there are quite a few languages, not every language, where the copula in the linking sense and the copula in the existing sense are expressed with the same word, you do sometimes get people using the word copula to refer to maybe anything that is and was and be can do, because it already has this handy word that refers to, technically speaking, one of its functions.
A good way to check whether it's the exist function is you can replace it with I think, therefore I exist.
Mm-hmm.
But we can't replace Lingthusiasm exists a podcast.
France exists bacon. I don't, yeah, it's not working for me.
So we can see how the copula has a broader set of functions. And this is just one particular function in English, but a good reminder as well that there is a lot of variation in what copulas can do across languages.
And, you know, in this particular case, like, I think therefore I am, which is cogito ergo sum in Latin, that is also using sum, which is part of the copula verb to be in Latin. So you can see how, okay, if you learn that sum is part of the copula in Latin, you might start saying, oh, any of this use of am or be is copulative, which is sometimes used in this less specific way.
Another language where the copula is highly irregular, as someone who is trying to learn that paradigm at the moment, I appreciate the benefit of being a native speaker of a language with a highly irregular copula set rather than having to learn it as an adult.
So you don't remember having learned all of the irregular copula forms. But there are also some cool things that copular constructions do differently across languages or similarly even in languages that aren't necessarily super related to each other. So one cool thing you can do with copulas is you can have several of them.
Excellent.
Yeah, more copulas are more fun. And you can use them, for example, to distinguish between temporary and ongoing states.
Okay.
So I think the example that people may have encountered about this is the Spanish ser versus estar, where ser is used for ongoing states and estar is used for things that are considered more temporary. So you could have something like estoy en la casa, I'm in the house, which is a temporary state, so I'm using the temporary copula, and soy lingüista, which is a permanent state, thank you, which means I'm a linguist.
Absolutely. Once a linguist, always a linguist.
Yeah. So, and it's used for professions, even if, you know, you're a teacher now, you might still use ser for that, even if you change careers in 10 years. But it's the idea of, like, is this relatively permanent or not permanent?
Mm-hmm.
The thing that really delighted me about learning these different verbs is that you can actually use them to distinguish between things that in English you would do with the adjective instead.
Okay.
So, estoy aburrida, I'm bored.
Because that's a temporary state, yeah.
Yeah, hopefully. But soy aburrida, which is the same word that I used for bored, is I'm boring, which is a ongoing state.
Oh, that's so much more permanent and intrinsic. Right. Okay.
But the interesting thing is that, so this is found in Spanish and Portuguese are fairly well known for having differences between ser and estar, but also Gaelic, and I think several of the other Celtic languages, although Scottish Gaelic is the one that I know, also has a distinction that's very much like ser and estar between temporary and ongoing states. So you can have something like hamiguma, where the ha, which is spelled T-H-A, is the temporary version of the copula, so I am well, versus is misha Gretchen, where the is, which sounds, you know, very different from ha, is the verb meaning I am Gretchen, my name is, myself is Gretchen.
Not a temporary state.
Not a temporary state. Even if you change your name, the idea is that names are things that are, you know, a little bit more ongoing than wellness, perhaps. And interestingly, you also have this distinction showing up in completely unrelated languages. So Chichewa is a Bantu language, which is spoken mainly in Malawi, and has a permanent versus temporary distinction, but only in the present.
Okay.
But you can do, you know, very sort of similar examples. The permanent example, and hopefully this is a somewhat accurate pronunciation of the Chichewa, ine ndine mpuzitsi, I am a teacher, which is, you know, sort of like being a linguist, an ongoing state, even if you retire eventually.
Yeah.
Whereas for temporary states, ie ali buino, he is well, which is the same thing with the Gaelic, I'm well. This is a thing that maybe today you're well or tomorrow you're not well. So, you know, knowing about a distinction like this means that you can kind of spot it in a variety of languages.
And a really good reminder that because copulas appear in so many languages, you can find similar functions across languages from completely different families and in completely different parts of the world, because there are thousands of human language experiments with what copulas do happening all around us.
Yeah.
When I was learning Nepali, one thing I had to learn to pay attention to in the copulas in Nepali was that they have different levels of politeness depending on the way that you want to convey yourself when communicating with people. So there's a distinction between a kind of common form, which can be impolite in some contexts, a kind of middle politeness form, which is a place I hang out a lot, and then a very polite form. So if I were to talk about someone I didn't know very well, I would say Australian ho, they are Australian. For middle politeness, Australian hun, they are Australian. And then if I was being polite, I would say Australian hunuhuncha, which is really just a very satisfying word to say. It's great that being polite is so satisfying in terms of the sound as well as the social status. It's something that happens across the whole verb paradigm, but you just use copulas so much in daily speaking, and it's not something I ever had to think about when using a copula in English.
I feel like this is also one of the ways that I identify whether or not someone's speaking Japanese.
Mm-hmm.
So Japanese has these two forms of the copula, da, which is informal, and desu, which is polite. And if you hear people ending their sentences with desu because the verb comes at the end of Japanese, you're like, oh, they're definitely speaking Japanese. I don't know what they're saying. I don't actually speak Japanese, but I can identify it because you hear, you know, in certain contexts, a lot of these polite copula forms that just keep going through. And yeah, it's just like another place for grammatical stuff to sort of show up. If you have a language that has a grammatical thing going on, the copula would be one place where it happens.
For example, in Yolmo and Shuba, as we talked about in our episode on evidentiality, this is where in the grammar the evidentials hang out. And so if you want to talk about something that you know from ongoing experience or because you have some kind of visual or smell or sound evidence, you will use a different form of the copula. And a bit like the English copula has some different functions, this can be pulled into like other structures where it's not really being used as a copula, it's just coming along for its evidential function.
You know, we've been talking a lot about, okay, this language has this word for copula, this language has many words for copula. But it's also worth pointing out that sometimes you can have languages do copula functions using constructions that are not actually really traceable to be a copula itself. You can make it do something else. So one example of this is from David Bowles on Twitter, who tweets a lot about Nahuatl, which is a language that I first used to pronounce Nahuatl, but I've since learned to pronounce Nahuatl, and spoken in South America. So he says that instead of, you know, dropping the copula or using a particular word that's a copula, they treat the noun or the adjective that you want to link with something as a verb. by adding a subject prefix to it.
Cool.
Yeah. So if you want to say something like beautiful is qualtzin, hopefully I'm pronouncing that somewhere near accuracy. But if you want to say you are beautiful, you'd say tiqualtzin, where the t is a subject prefix meaning you. And so you're essentially making beautiful into a verb, you know, I beautiful, you beautiful, he or she beautifuls. And rather than putting a separate word in to link it, you're just treating it like you would any other verb in the language.
It's a really great example of how a copula function can be more than just looking for a copula verb in a language.
Which is another reason why it's useful to have a word like copula to say, ah, here is this function that we can sort of trace through the different strategies that languages use to accomplish it, some of which correspond to particular verbs and some of which don't.
I know Auslan doesn't have a specific copula either, which is not to say it doesn't have a copula function. To do a copula, you have the subject and then you have the other thing that you're linking it with, whether it's a location or an attribute. So word order is very important for establishing a copula relationship. So if I wanted to say something like Lingthusiasm is a podcast, I would sign Lingthusiasm and then I would sign podcast. And there are some secondary channels that you can use. So things like your facial expression, you would generally use like some raised eyebrows to indicate for the first half that that is the topic and then the other bit is what you're linking to it. So it's not that it doesn't have a copula function, it's just that you're not looking for a particular single sign that has that function.
And it's not that you're just sort of like doing these two signs sequentially with nothing indicating that there's any relationship to them because there are the, you know, non-manual signs that are on your face and stuff that are indicating, yeah, there's a relationship here that I'm talking about them in juxtaposition with each other.
Yeah. And I think ASL does something similar. I don't know if it's more common in signed languages because they have this spatial resource to make use of to not need a particular word for the copula function. There might be other signed languages that do have a specific signed copula. I'm sure that for something like signed English, which is a more literal sign equivalent of English, there probably is one because you're trying to sign all the English words. But for Auslan, there's no specific copula sign.
Nice. And this just gets us into something that sometimes comes up when we're talking about copulas, which is languages that sometimes put the copula and sometimes don't, which is different from the situation in Nahuatl or in Auslan, where you do a different type of construction that is not traceable as a single word to being a copula. Mm-hmm. But in Arabic, for example, when I was learning Arabic and I was coming in, like I studied a bunch of languages before and I was like, yeah, okay. So I know that one of the words that's really useful to learn early on is like be and am and is. And, you know, sometimes there's some irregularity, but they're pretty common. Like I should try to learn these. And my textbook and my instructor was like, yeah, no. In Arabic, in the present tense, and if there isn't a negation going on, there just isn't a word for the copula.
And of course, it's worth being very clear that the fact that there is no word is what makes it meaningful, that it's a zero copula.
Right. It's a zero copula. There isn't a word. And so if you want to say something like the book is big, you could say al-kitab kabir, which is literally the book big, but you distinguish it from the big book, which would be al-kitab al-kabir, which is literally the book, the big, and that the is linking it and saying, okay, these are both part of the same noun phrase, whereas because you didn't have the, okay, there's an understood copula there. But it's null, and it's, you know, not something you literally say. However, if you want to say the book is not big or the book was big or something like that, then you need to add another verb, kana or laisa, to indicate the negation of the past tense. So there is a copula elsewhere in the language, but in the simplest case of the copula, which is just linking two things in that sort of default present, no negation going on, no funny business, you juxtaposing the words by itself is enough and is in fact the only thing that you do.
The World Atlas of Linguistic Structures has a survey of how common it is to be able to do this zero copula without having a specific copula word there.
Mm-hmm.
And it's relatively small by WALS standards. There's like 400 languages. And in the survey, it's possible to do this zero copula thing, like Arabic, in about 45% of the languages they surveyed. So it's
nice.
By no means uncommon if you're learning a language and you encounter a zero copula. It does happen in quite a broad range of languages. It's not just like it's common thing in one particular language family. In fact, Russian is known for having a zero copula in the present tense, which I find really interesting as a Polish speaker, which does have a present copula in that form. So closely related languages can do different things, just as we saw similar things happening across very different and non-related languages. The thing I find really interesting about the Russian one is that apparently there was a present tense copula all the way up until the 19th century. So if you read something like Dostoevsky, you'll see this form. But because it's in something like Dostoevsky, now if people use it, it has like this archaic effect when you speak or use it in writing.
Sort of like using something from Shakespeare like thou art.
Yeah.
You know, because we're familiar with this from literature, but it's not something that's right there.
Yes. Unfortunately, we've lost art from our paradigm, just as the Russians have lost their present tense copula. So some languages will have a zero or potentially some stylistic effect from choosing to include it or not.
Well, and this is a great segue into talking about the zero copula in African-American English, which is also an example of this sort of like very close contact linguistic variation with Russian and Polish, where my variety of English, sort of mainstream North American English, requires a copula in the present tense. Most of the time, I'm going to put an asterisk on this because there's a few contexts where I don't have to do it.
Okay.
But in African-American English, you can have a sentence like some of them big and some of them small, which means some of them are big and some of them are small. But interestingly, there's a lot of constraints on this as well. So again, it's only in the present tense. It's not with negation.
Okay.
And you can't do it with am.
Interesting. So a real consistent grammatical structure to how these copulas get used.
Right. And which is interestingly similar to how you can't do like am not, amn't with am. Like there's some weird stuff going on with English am.
Something about first person that makes everyone very sensitive to their copula use.
Yeah, it's interesting. So there's rules around this. And, you know, when people do like terrible parodies of African-American English, they often aren't paying attention to the specific constraints on the rules for when you can and can't do this.
Okay, and now I need to know what contexts you find it's possible to not use a copula.
Well, so I didn't think I had any examples of null copula, but when we were looking up information about this, I realized there's also a construction in English where you can say something like, the more the merrier.
A classic quote right there.
Classic quote, and that is a null copula, my friends.
Is it just because of how ubiquitous that saying is?
I don't know. Like, there's a few fixed phrases like the more the merrier, the more the better, that are sort of classic quotes. And I don't know if I can do, like, the more the hungrier. Like, can I put other stuff in that context?
The later, the sleepier?
Yeah, I don't know. It kind of works. But it's in that sort of comparative construction where it seems to work. And also, there is a news headline null copula in English.
Oh my gosh, that is true.
So I went and got a few examples of this, unfortunately not from classic quotes, because there aren't really classic quotes that are news headlines also.
Oh gosh, you got them from news headlines. Am I going to be able to cope with this?
I got them from news headlines from The Onion.
Okay, thank you.
For comic value.
Mm-hmm.
So a few of these are, area woman not yelling at you, she's just saying.
I like that one because they've snuck one into the second half, she's just saying, but
right.
In any other context, I would have to say area woman is not yelling at you.
Right, exactly. Neighbor oblivious to fact he being groomed for cat sitting.
Okay, that one broke my brain. So neighbor is oblivious to the fact he is being groomed for cat sitting.
Right. So neighbor oblivious kind of works as a news headline null copula, but he being groomed, I think it's maybe something about the he that's really not quite working as a null copula for me there either.
I think it's also just something about the fact that it's such a not news headline topic that makes it very hard for my brain to take it seriously.
I mean, this is something that comes up when you get headlines from The Onion, admittedly.
Yeah.
Friendship moving way too fast.
Friendship is moving way too fast would not sound like a headline in the way this does.
And finally, study, more parents opting for one big baby over multi-child household, which is a very weird stock photo.
That really does sound like a newspaper headline, and I thought newspaper headlines mostly came about by like removing the or a, but you're right. Removing the copula is what really makes them hit as newspapers vibe.
Mm-hmm.
At the start of the episode, we talked about the linking function of copulas and this existence function that they have in English as well.
We can think of these as the France is Bacon function and the to be or not to be function, yes?
But these are by no means the only functions that the copula has in English. Because it's this tiny functional word, it gets picked up in a whole bunch of other uses as well. It's worth just doing a brief tour of some of those.
The copula is also sometimes used something like, I am eating the cake, or the cake was eaten. That am and was are both forms of the verb to be. And so sometimes they get sort of dragged in and said, oh, well, if we say anything that's to be is part of the copula, sometimes they'll get talked about as a copula, even though technically what they're doing is not quite the same type of linking.
Yeah.
Although like an interesting sort of complication that happens there is if you have a sentence like the shirt was torn, is that referring to the same thing as like the shirt was green? The adjective that I'm applying to the shirt is torn. Or am I saying the shirt was torn by the dog and that it's a verb? So you can sort of see why in something like the shirt was torn or the cake was eaten, you might want to talk about a copula from a like linking perspective, even though it's not necessarily going to be a function that's expressed by a copula in a different language that might actually have a different way of expressing a passive.
And then on top of all of this, we have other words like become, which in some contexts have a copula-like function. So something like, I became hungry, appears to have this linking of two attributes that has a real copula vibe to it.
Yeah, so you have something like feel, and it feels hot,
mm-hmm.
or seem, good company makes a trip seem shorter, if we want to have a quotey feel. And you could sometimes use be in replace of them, like it, you know, it is hot, I am tired, makes a trip become shorter or be shorter. You know, there's sort of words you can use in sort of some context as a synonym for be that also provide that kind of link.
We have a term for these. They're called pseudocopulas because they're kind of doing a copula thing, but not always and not with that specific set of functions that copula verbs have, but worth keeping an eye out for them anyway.
When I think about copulas, I also remember a game that I used to play with some friends in high school.
Okay.
So one of my friends had discovered this proposal for a philosophical language form called E-prime.
Oh.
And this was a form of English, which is the E, which doesn't use any of the forms of the verb to be.
Okay. Having now spent a good half an hour chatting about the forms of this verb, this feels like quite a mental exercise.
Right. And so there's, you know, some level of philosophical justification of like, maybe this will make your thoughts clearer, because if you say, you know, the sky is blue, what you really mean is the sky appears blue to me. And so you should, you know, basically be using pseudocopulas, mm-hmm. as we just talked about, instead of a proper copula, because how do you know the sky is really blue? And shouldn't you be sort of watching what you assert?
So it's really forcing you to make use of those pseudo-copulas,
yeah.
because they fit into a lot of those constructions very nicely.
Right. And I think, you know, maybe there's an interesting point to be made about sort of being very precise in terms of what you can state is true. But also, one thing is that we realized over the course of a few different lunch breaks, you know, playing this game of like, what if we didn't use the verb to be, is that there's all these other forms that to be has that are probably not really required to be omitted in order for greater intellectual precision and clarity of thought, as the grandiose claims go. You know, if you say something like, I am eating, are you really being less precise than I eat?
I imagine it helps you focus your thinking by basically completely freezing you up sentence to sentence, because you have to think about all these different functions. And a function word is something we tend to take for granted in our vocabulary.
Right, exactly. And it's kind of like, you know, I subsequently played an improv game where you can't use any words with the letter S in it just to, you know, mess with you.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it works better as sort of a game of just to mess with you of what if you thought about your linguistic forms a lot and tried to play this kind of gotcha game, then actually I don't think it gave us any additional philosophical clarity when we were playing it.
It would be really fun if you're writing some sci-fi at the moment. It would be really fun to have the aliens make it through the whole book using no copulas in English translation. They have to speak E prime.
Oh, that would be interesting. Yeah, you do sometimes get people writing books without the letter E or something. So I think you could do it as a, you know, written exercise in a way that's a lot harder to do, like, in real time.
This was a delightfully philosophical ending to our discussion about copulas. Since we started with inspirational quotes, should we maybe finish with some inspirational quotes and change some to be about copulas?
I absolutely think we should change some philosophical quotes to be about copulas.
Okay.
I want to say that life is like a box of copulas.
Very profound. You must be the copula you wish to see in the world.
For more Lingthusiasm and links to all the things mentioned in this episode, go to lingthusiasm.com. You can listen to us on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, SoundCloud, YouTube, or wherever else you get your podcasts. And you can follow at Lingthusiasm on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and Tumblr. You can get IPA scarves, not judging your grammar, just analyzing it t-shirts, and other Lingthusiasm merch at lingthusiasm.com/merch. I can be found as at Gretchen A. McSee on Twitter. My blog is allthingslinguistic.com, and my book about internet language is called Because Internet.
I tweet and blog as Superlinguo. Have you listened to all the Lingthusiasm episodes and you wish there were more? You can get access to 60 bonus episodes to listen to right now at patreon.com/lingthusiasm or follow the links from our website. Patrons also get access to our Discord chat room to talk with other linguistics fans and other rewards such as helping to keep the show ad-free. Recent bonus topics include the Linguistics Olympiads, text encoding, and a chat where we interview each other. If you can't afford to pledge, that's okay too. We also really appreciate it if you can recommend Lingthusiasm to anyone who needs a little more linguistics in their lives.
Lingthusiasm is created and produced by Gretchen McCulloch and Lauren Gawne. Our senior producer is Claire Gawne, our editorial producer is Sarah Dapirala, our production manager is Liz McCullough, and our music is Ancient City by The Triangles.
Stay Lingthusiastic.